Good evening, everyone. As mentioned, I'll be talking about the unlimited and endless possibilities for a better and holistic glycemic control when a smartphone needs a glucometer, forming a digital yet affordable connected care ecosystem. Dr. Mudit Sabharwal, I'm a practicing diabetologist at Delhi and NCR. Now, as per the recent indices by International Diabetes Federation and various other forums, more than 77 million people in India suffers with diabetes, and about 80% of them with an alarmingly high HbA1c of around 8.5 on an average. A typical journey of a person with diabetes starts with discovering diabetes-related symptoms when his health starts to deteriorate. He then visits a doctor and gets himself tested, which leads to the discovery of uncontrolled glycemic values and other metabolic markers. This leads him to a state of denial, shock, and helplessness when he looks for other references that may or may not be scientific in nature. Again, so this basically creates a havoc in his life. So again, he's subjected to, when he visits the doctor, he's subjected to medication and lifestyle changes that burdens him with their high cost, affordability, and compliance issues, leading to poor adherence to the complete regime, missing regular follow-ups with the doctor, and again, ultimately worsening his HbA1c levels and other biomedical markers. Again, the Indian diabetes care landscape has several fundamental challenges, which may be categorized into three major categories. So again, first of all, it's the accessibility, where 95% of people with diabetes are from tier 2 cities, and who can actually approach only 5% of endocrinologists available in these cities and beyond. And hence, only 8% of these individuals are able to seek a specialist for treatment. The next is the lack of awareness among people with diabetes, where 70% of them remain unaware about severity of the impact of disease and to the various organs. And just 10% or less have been introduced to diabetes education or health coach ever. The third one is the affordability, where high cost of medication may lead to lack of compliance and adherence to the given treatment regime. Moreover, the indices say that only 12% of these diabetes patients were ever subjected to glucometer monitoring. So what is the solution for these problems? The solution to these problems may include a high engaging digital care solution or platform to manage and to control diabetes at a large scale. Its components may include collection, tracking, and analysis of various data points for a patient, including his blood glucose values, biomarkers, weight, BP readings, and steps, and sharing them through a cloud or other sources for real-time AI-based actionable insights and nudges for immediate support on his uncontrolled values and trends. And then sharing them with a certified diabetes educator or a health coach for providing management and assistance on his current high or low values, maintenance of his values in safe range through individualized nutrition, physical activity, and adherence to the prescribed diabetes medication. And additionally, instant alerts which are sent to his registered care providers or loved ones and to his doctor on his dashboard for further change in the treatment regime and prevention of such events in future. Now again, a holistic, connected, affordable care ecosystem has been successful in demonstrating clinical outcomes among monitoring population and also has been responsible for expanding the diabetes care in the community at large. In reference to some of the studies published in various forums, glucose monitoring and individualized health coaching leads to about 1.1% HbA1c reduction, about 10% drop in the average fasting blood glucose levels, and about 60% hypoglycemia event reduction in just 45 days. Moreover, this impact has been seen in about 70% of diabetes patients from non-tier 1 cities, majorly tier 2 and tier 3 cities, where 55% of them were using a glucometer for the very first time, and 83% of them were connected to a diabetes educator for the first time ever in their life. Now we know from the UKPDA study, each 1% drop in HbA1c reduces the 10-year risk from suffering all from all microvascular diseases by 37%, heart attacks by 14%, stroke by 12%, and peripheral vascular diseases by 43%, which ultimately leads to a 12% drop in death rate. Hence, this digitally connected care ecosystem adds a great value in managing diabetes and its complications at large. Now let's look into certain evidence for the impact of connected continuous care on diabetes management. Now this was a study published in Diabetes Metabolic Syndrome and Obesity: Targets in Therapy in 2021, where more than 7,000 type 2 diabetes patients were subjected to the connected care ecosystem, including digitally supported and real time self monitoring of blood glucose, driven counseling by the certified diabetes educator, nudges and alerts. Now again, there was a high reduction within 45 days, including 60% reduction in hypoglycemic episodes post counseling, 81% reduction in 81% patient had no hypoglycemic episodes post counseling, 9.9% reduction in preparenteral blood glucose and 9.2% reduction in the postprandial blood glucose respectively. Again, another study published as a poster in ADA, which included more than 7,500 patients, where reduction within 45 days showed that there was 9.3% reduction in preprandial blood glucose, 8.9% reduction in postprandial blood glucose, 9.5% reduction in fasting blood glucose, and 6% reduction in the random blood glucose values when the patients were subjected to the connected care ecosystem. Again, another recent poster published in ATDD. So again, this was again on a large patient base with more than 2,500 patients who were subjected to AI-enabled digital diabetes care ecosystem. And there was about more than 45% reduction in the postprandial hypoglycemia incidences, about 40% reduction in preprandial hypoglycemia, 51% reduction in fasting hypoglycemia, and about 39% reduction in the random hypoglycemia incidences. So it not only reduces the glycemia at large, it also helps in reducing the hypoglycemic episodes at various levels. Now this is a recent study which was published in ATTD 2022 as an abstract. So again, this was a 90-day study where the SMBG triggered CDE counseling effectively controlled overall hyperglycemia and maintained good in-range blood glucose levels during the lockdown phase in 2020. So again, within 90 days, there was a reduction of average blood glucose by 16%, fasting hypoglycemia by 81%, pre-meal hypoglycemia by 72.5%, and about post-meal hypoglycemia for about 68%. Again, let's talk about some of its affordability. On the affordability of the continuous care, which actually benefits the patient. Now I'll talk about a case where Mr. Nitin Bhide, who is a 45-year-old male from Pune. He had a known history of type 2 diabetes since last 3 years and was on two OADs, including sitagliptin 100 mg and metformin 500 mg twice a day. Now on examinations, he had a normal BMI with HbA1c of 9%. Fasting blood glucose of 195 and PP of 240. Again, he was subjected to, as his HbA1c was quite high, even after two OHAs, he was given injection degludec, which 12 units once a day, sitagliptin 100 mg and metformin was continued. He was basically in shock and depression because of uncontrolled diabetes and the insulin initiation. He felt that he was burdening his family with the higher medical cost. Now he was referred by his physician to Beto's digitally connected continuous care program, where he was provided with a smartphone connected glucometer, regular reading reminders as per his critical medical profile, and alerts were sent to his caregiver for all the out of range readings. Now he also received actionable insights which were pushed to him on all the readings as a guidance on for managing and preventing hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia episodes, and the data-driven chatbot, which actually did some interception in between. Also, he received regular guidance and support by a diabetes coach to maintain his blood glucose values in trends in range through individualized diabetes and exercise regime, diabetes diet and exercise regime. Additionally, he was also given certain support on further lifestyle correction through some videos on yoga, diet recipes, etc. digitally. Now, after 3 months, there was a great impact. So again, his insulin was stopped. Sitagliptin and metformin continued. His HbA1c came down from 9% to 7.8. Fasting came down from 195 to 138 and PP from 238 to 184. All other biomarkers were good and there were no hypoglycemia incidences at all. So again, he was quite happy. He, you know, exercised regularly and he felt quite empowered. Now, the key takeaways from my side would be from this talk is basically the digital and mobile-based connected care ecosystem should be considered as a useful aid to the standard diabetes management protocols. Studies have shown that digital ecosystem help control HbA1c, fasting blood glucose, PP blood glucose, and moreover, reduction in the hypoglycemia episodes, which are more critical for these patients. And again, making the ecosystem affordable will aid to democratize diabetes management very effectively at a very large scale. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Sabharwal. That was an excellent discussion, and I quite enjoyed all the studies that you had presented as well, the original work that you have done in the field. We are actually unable to reach the next speaker. So before that, can we fill in by asking maybe a couple of questions, if anyone has any questions to ask the previous speakers? We have Dr. Wang and Dr. Sabharwal with us. Dr. Wang, are you here with us? Yes. So had a question to ask you, Dr. Wang, if I may. As I had mentioned, the One Touch Reveal program is something that many of us clinicians have started using and found pretty useful to integrate into our practice. And patients themselves have actually found it very useful as well. But what I wanted to ask you is, in a country like India, where digital literacy is probably not as high as other parts of the world, but it is still picking up, of course, what were the challenges that you faced with integrating this, in other words, the patient acceptability from the patient's end, and more so also from clinician's end? Because I remember when I, the initial discussion at one of the programs that I attended, I found that many of the doctors were concerned about the legal implications behind, patients reporting their blood glucose. And if, for example, a patient had a hypoglycemia and they'd entered that into the One Touch Reveal, and if it has not been picked up by the doctor, if the doctor does not respond immediately, what are the legal implications? So there were some apprehensions that that I noticed that doctors did have initially when the One Touch Reveal program was initially brought up. So what were the challenges that you faced in that front is what I wanted to ask.
Thank you, Dr. Arun. I think that's an excellent comment and question. Actually, that's the first time that I've heard of such a legal concern. And I guess what goes through my mind is that a One Touch Reveal ecosystems, much like other digital solutions, is not really meant to be a real-time alert system. So I think it does help with remote monitoring because, you have a set time, for example, at this particular time, you set up a remote consultation, or, if the patient, constantly uploading their data and they come into your clinic, then the HCP, their attending physician, can quickly pull up the report, have a look at the summary so that it basically makes the interpretation of the results and the patterns, are they high, where are they low in the day, et cetera, to be much faster. But at least in my experience, I've not actually heard of much use of it, well, trying to use it as a real-time alert system to say, oh, you have hyperglycemia. What are you going to do? And I think that's, where certainly CGM will come into play, because I think there's always a place for BGM, digital apps, and also CGM going into the future. And so CGM with their alerts and alarms will definitely have a much stronger force in that light. But even then, I mean, even if the CGM is connected to a cloud system, it's not really meant to be something that's alerting the healthcare professionals immediately, because everyone is busy, and you can't be on call 24/7 a day, 365 days a year. Although that would be ideal. So that's my comment. To your other comment about the experiences in India, it's funny because my role covers both India, China, and Japan. And I can tell you that the pace of digital solutions pickup in Japan is actually much slower than India. So you'd be surprised. And I think it's more to do with the mindset, actually. Your comment strikes me as a little bit surprising, actually, because I would say that, wow, Japanese patients and doctors should be more like the Indian healthcare professionals and patients. So in that sense, that was one reaction that I had. But not limited to India, but I've seen in my experience with Alone Apps and then also across other app providers is this idea of engagement, that there needs to be a constant, consistent engagement between the healthcare professional and the patients in order for them to be continue to use the app. So I think that's certainly a hurdle, because I've seen reports where if the healthcare professional is actually not providing feedback based off the reports from, say, One Touch Reveal, at least in a consistent manner, across visits, then the patients tend to drop off much more quickly, because they see, well, what's the point? And there is, maybe that's more related to an Asian ethos compared to, say, the Western cultures, where patients tend to want to do more things themselves. But at least what I see in Asia Pac is that patients tend to listen more to their healthcare professionals, want to do more, not only for their own health, but also to do more for their own doctors as well in that sense. So there's certainly that engagement piece that I find very important, and I see consistent across all the countries. I don't know if that helps to answer some parts of your question.
It does, absolutely. I'm in fact very happy to hear that you think the Indian population acceptability is much higher than, as you said, compared to Japan. Yeah. What I was more pointing out to was the challenges in terms of the digital literacy rates. And if you compare, Japan, for instance, to the Indian population, majority of, because in the urban areas, you'd find digital literacy a lot higher. So that's in terms of numbers that you'd probably find comparing India and another country like Japan, you'd probably find that's where that question actually came from.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. So actually, That points me to the study that I introduced during my talk, the To Salute study, because, to your point, it's not an issue that is only, seen in India. It's actually an issue shared across all the markets, really, that there are gaps in understanding. There are also differences in numeracy and literacy. And so what the To Salute study tried to show was that it doesn't matter if you have low literacy or numeracy. If you are using Barrier Flex and the One Touch Reveal system, because it is color coded, so you actually don't need to understand the numbers at its most basic level. But you can just say, okay, if it's red, then you're high, and if you're green, you're in range, etc. So it just takes a little bit of coaching and understanding, and you can kind of tailor to the patient's literacy and numeracy, depending on how much you think they need to do, how much you think they can comprehend to manage their diabetes that way as well. So, you know, the meters and the apps, it's not for everyone. I'll concede that. But it does give you more to offer patients if you think that they are ready for an app amongst other tools that they can use to manage diabetes.
Absolutely. Yeah. I completely agree with you. And I think apps like this and technology in general has literally enriched, you know, the management of diabetes, and the way forward is, you know, integrating technology into healthcare. And having said that, I also must tell you that I've seen patients who come in with their one-touch reveal, you know, with their data, and then they proudly present it to you and, you know, show you their red zones and the green zones. So patients are very happy, and yeah, it's definitely a very useful tool. Dr. Sabharwal, would you like to add any comments that you have, or anything that you'd like to add?
Yeah, definitely, Dr. Anjana. I mean, as just adding to Dr. Wong's comments, I mean, again, the data which is now available has a very enriched, probably, I mean, it's enriching, and it's actually easier to interpret. It clearly shows that, I mean, if we compare the connected care ecosystems over here, I mean, let's say, for example, BTOs, I mean, it's like, a patient can clearly see where exactly the fluctuations are. I mean, it's CGM is an important part of our diabetes treatment protocols nowadays, but then again, it's not easily available, and it's not affordable by all patients. So I guess the glucometer, probably the connected care ecosystem through an SMBG.
This is an important thing, and this is the aspect what I'm going.
It actually helps, and it basically becomes, it actually helps making the whole diabetes management affordable, giving a similar kind of impact in the whole management, management result when we actually see a patient. And again, it basically helps in getting better results in the treatment itself. So the patient himself knows where are the fluctuations going on, and how is basically, where exactly were the hypoglycemia episodes. The doctor can interpret hypoglycemia episodes and make the changes in the treatment protocols.
Dr. Jack, I would like to thank you for accepting our invitation and taking out time for this World Congress of Diabetes Technology. And your talk was excellent, wonderful. I just, in one of your slides, you have shown that there are more than 3 lakh fitness app or the health coaching apps which are available right now. So the dilemma comes, how does one person chooses the right one? So there is a lot of, as during the inaugural ceremony, our chief guest, the guest of honor, Dr. Shashank Joshi, he talked about that one of the important responsibility of any forum dealing with technology is to deal with the misinformation also. So we need to deal with the information overload, information clutter, and lots of information, the information which is not evidence-based, it travels very fast. But the science doesn't happen the same with the science. Science is always looked upon with suspicion, but something coming up with the non-scientific person will travel very fast. So how do we identify the right app, right things, and for our patients?
First of all, it's my pleasure to be, you know, participating in this Congress. Thank you for your kind words, Dr. Gupta. The next little question, to which I have no answer to, because that was actually pointed out in the recommendation by the ADA and EASD as one of the biggest issues, that there is a lot of clutter, and how do you choose? And so that was the genesis of how they came to that recommendation. Like, I mean, they say that, for example, from a healthcare professional's perspective, you know, you should do your research before you choose an app, or try to, you know, talk to the patients about the apps before you start using it. But now, while that is ideal, you probably don't have time to actually do all of that, right? So I think while there are that many digital apps out there, the truth of the matter is that a lot of them are probably just out in the App Store and not really doesn't come with a lot of information. There is also a lot of mismanagement. For example, the versions are not updated regularly. And this is covering a whole spectrum of apps. You know, it's covering from, say, things like Beta, One-Touch Reveal, to all the way to like very simple like nutrition apps or menu apps, etc. So it is a wide spectrum. But what you didn't see, what it didn't show in that the 3 lakh number is actually there's a lot of flux. Like I think every year there's like 50,000 apps that are deleted, and then another 50,000 that are added. So there's actually a lot of flux in there. But I guess to try to answer your question, my guess would be that the manufacturers or the companies will have a very big role to play in this, and with responsibility to provide information in the form of clinical evidence that I presented, also Dr. Sabharwal also just presented, trying to be able to provide that information in a manner that makes sense, and be able to answer your questions. Also have, whether it's from the sales reps from the company or whether it's customer care websites, all that support set up properly in order to ensure that at least there is a portal for information gathering should that be required. So I think that's probably the biggest difference between, say, company like MyScan that has that scale and be able to provide that support versus maybe an app that was just built and left there on the App Store. So yeah, while the number is big, I think there are probably a lot less useful apps with that sort of support that can help healthcare professionals better make the choice of which apps to use. Does that help somewhat?
Yes, thank you, Dr. Jack. You have answered that very aptly. Mudit, I have one question to you also related to the same thing. As you know, you talked about a smartphone gets connected to a glucometer, so possibilities are unlimited. So one of the things you talked about is the way you inform patients, you keep track of their sugar levels, and you intervene. So how do you decide on the frequency? Because sometimes that can also be invasive to the patient. Because many of the times, there are patients who actually appreciate that. But on the other hand, you have the patients who do not actually appreciate this. So how do you define the frequency, and what is your experience because you are using it for a longer time? So and how do you wish to address that?
Thank you so much, sir, for your question. So first of all, I believe that there are two incidences, and number one is hypoglycemia. So the intervention should be done, and probably that is again defined, very clearly defined. If someone's glucose falls down below the critical level, so the CDE and the AI nudging system automatically intervene and pushes off nudges to prevent, to control, to manage and to prevent hypoglycemia in future. And the patient is actually sent, the data is sent to a CDE or a health or a diabetes coach for guidance to the patient. The chatbot actually intercepts in between by probably guiding and guiding the patient on the protocols to prevent and manage hypoglycemia. Now, secondly, again, hypoglycemia when the sugar levels goes beyond 240. So that's basically again another trigger. When the patient is intervened in a similar manner for management and prevention of hyperglycemia in future. The third part is when we see, generally it's the trends. So it's actually if someone's glucose values are going trending to an uncontrolled level from a normal values to hyperglycemia levels, or probably normal values to hyperglycemia levels. Or if there are multiple fluctuations, which we can probably see in the SMPG patterns, then the intervention similarly comes into picture when the diabetes coaches intervene and guide the patient to manage the state. It's actually, and the intervention as per se is not just telling them what to do. It's actually goes beyond the diet and exercise. It's actually a pre-clinical approach where patient is guided on the diabetes diet, which is individualized as per the patient's requirements, as per his patient's as per the patient's medical profile. And again, I mean, the exercise regime, which is again as per individual, very individualized as per the patient's own clinical and personal profile.
Dr. Mudit, if I can ask a question.
Please, sir.
Are you there, Dr. Mudit?
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Yes. So, see, the connected smartphones and the devices which are connected to smartphones, people are concerned about, you know, the digital footprints. So, whenever you, you know, go on Google and search for something, you start getting advertisements for that same product on different devices and different platforms. So, are you concerned about that while, you know, connecting your device, mobile device to a smartphone?
Generally not, sir. If in case it is properly regulated, I guess most of the devices are HIPAA compliant, and probably if they are properly regulated as per the FDA protocols, then I guess these things can be avoided.
No, but the guidelines are for devices, not for the apps, I guess. So like, you know, if you are connecting your device to an app which is not regulated by any guidelines, so that app would track your activity and maybe then, you know.
Sir, it depends. I would say, sorry to intervene, sir. Sir, it depends. What is the intention of the device? What is the intention of the app to track your activity? If an app is tracking, and as Dr. Wang also said, if an app is tracking your blood glucose levels or biomarkers and helping you and guiding you in management and prevention of acute events and managing your diabetes. Regularly and in a better manner, then I guess patients are always happy because they have a second hand which is holding them when the doctor is not available. So it's as
but along with that, it's tracking other activities as well. So that risk is always there. Like, you know, being the rebel sector advocate, I would say that people who are using such devices which are connected to apps, they always have this question that would that track my activities? So
generally, all the certified and regulated apps and devices, both of them, are generally regulated. As Dr. Wong said, there are lakhs of apps available on the App Store. I'm sure I don't know about others, but yes, I guess whether it is OneTouch, or whether it is Beto, or whether it is any other good company, they generally take care of these regulations.
Dr. Wang, do you want to add something to this?
No, I completely agree. I mean, there are not only in India but across the globe, there are very clear regulations on cybersecurity depending on the markets it goes. I think, you know, it's a lot more stricter now in Europe and the US, for example. So we certainly do need to ensure that our cloud systems, the servers that we store all the information, for example, comply with those strict regulations, because otherwise, to your point, there's always that worry and concern from not only from patients but also from healthcare professionals about, well, is there going to be a leakage of your data, etc. So I think that's also one of the things that was pointed out in the recommendations by the ABA and EASD, that you do need to comply with these regulations, and not all the apps do, but certainly the more reputable manufacturers will need to comply with that, because it is something to do with the brand recognition as well. So that's the only thing that I'll add.
Thank you.